On completion of this chapter, you will have an understanding of the procedures for loading, the obligation to inform superiors, the standard record requirements, the alerting sequence and response in case of emergency, the effect on moorings during loading, the principles of the Vapor Return System, VRS, or Volatile Emission Control, VOC, the procedures for topping off cargo tanks and complete loading, the process of final cargo survey, ullage, temperatures, water dip, sampling, cargo calculation, the process for cargo release. From the time the tanker is secured at berth, what is the normal sequence of activities until the cargo loading begins? The cargo loading normally commences according to the following procedure. Formalities with port authorities and terminal or loading master are completed. Cargo hoses arms, well connected, and unused manifold connections blanked. The vapor return line is connected, VOC system prepared. Cargo surveyors complete the tank survey. Onboard quantity, or OBQ, is calculated. Lining up of lines and valves to be used, both onshore and on board, under the supervision of the chief officer and loading master. When lining up is completed, the chief officer reports to the loading master that the vessel is ready to receive cargo, except for manifold valves which still are closed. The loading master orders the vessel's manifold valves to be opened according to the agreed loading plan. When the manifold valves are confirmed open, the loading master orders loading to start, first with line displacement at reduced rate. The duty deck officer, pumpman and bosun with deck crew must, during this sequence, check valves and lines in use to ensure that no malfunction or leaks have occurred when the cargo oil entered. To ensure that there is correct lineup of valves for drop lines, bottom lines and tank valves, the first cargo is taken into one tank at reduced rate. When confirmed that the oil flow is according to the loading plan, the remaining tanks are opened and the loading rate is gradually increased. When the junior deck officer is in charge of a cargo watch, why can he not take all decisions independently? When the loading is well underway, the chief officer delegates the practical operation to the duty deck officer, pumpman, and bosun. The chief officer's standing order details the duty deck officer's obligation to inform the superiors in the event of incidents or accidents that may interfere with the operation, for instance, oil leaks, breaking of moorings, thunderstorms, etc. In addition, the chief officer requires to be kept updated on the progress of the loading and any deviation from the loading plan, such as reduced loading rate or stoppages initiated by shore, etc. The need to inform superiors whenever in doubt is to prevent one-man errors during the operation and to use the best experience available to address unforeseen risks which may occur from time to time and which have not been allowed for in the plan. Besides the need to record all events to serve as evidence in case of legal disputes later, how does keeping of records help in the operation of the tanker? The duty deck officer is responsible for recording all activities in the timesheet, which is one of the official documents to be enclosed with the final cargo documents. He is also responsible for recording all items required by the deck log and to make regular checks and printouts of the vessel's condition according to the loading computer. Besides legal requirements, a good recording helps to review the operation in a debriefing after completion and for continuously improving plans to be made by the ship's team. What emergency action must be taken by personnel on duty without waiting for the chief officer to come and take charge? In case of an emergency, the duty deck officer, pumpman and bosun must be familiar with the first response action to be taken and the sequence of alerting as per the ship shore safety checklist and emergency telephone list. Emergency response. Click on the button to learn more. What is the risk to the transfer operations while loading is in progress when the tide is low? As the sea level goes down with the tide and the vessel goes down deeper into the water due to cargo being loaded, the mooring ropes become slack. It is then possible that the vessel may move several meters off the berth. The duty deck officer, in cooperation with the bosun and the deck watchmen, are responsible for adjusting the mooring ropes as the vessel changes draft and trim, and as an effect of tide. If the terminal's loading arms come under strain, it will become necessary to stop the cargo transfer and tighten the mooring ropes until the vessel is secure alongside again. Why should the junior officers and crew be aware of vapor emissions from oil cargoes and their control systems? The junior officers must be familiar with the operation of the vessel's vapor emission control system. Although it is mandatory to equip crude oil tankers with either a vapor return system or volatile emission control system, at present only a few terminals are equipped to receive the vapor in return from ships. Vapors emitted from oil cargo are toxic and can harm human health. Emissions into the atmosphere are also prohibited by law in more and more ports around the world. Since pollution by oil is no longer a threat from ballast water, what is the reason for increased regulations and controls when deballasting? Since the introduction of double-hulled crude oil tankers, where the ballast water is carried in the double-hull side tanks and completely segregated from the cargo tanks, the risk of oil pollution has been reduced dramatically. The old single-hulled crude oil tankers, SBT and CBT Category 1, 2 and 3, are being phased out according to MARPOL regulations and are not included in this module. Ballast water carried by crude oil tankers is governed by IMO and MARPOL's stringent regulations. Because of environmental issues, new regulations require all vessels to carry a ship-specific water ballast management plan. The major concern now is to prevent biologically invasive species, such as the zebra mussel carried in ballast water taken in cargo discharge ports, which tend to destroy the delicate ecological balance at the cargo loading ports. What are the two aims of a well-planned deballasting operation? The junior officers or duty deck officers and the pump man will normally operate the ballast pumps and carry out the deballasting operation simultaneously with the loading operation. It is important to carry out the deballasting operation as scheduled in the loading plan, both in order to avoid unwanted loads to the vessel's hull and to ensure that the ballast tanks are emptied and well drained in due time prior to topping off cargo tanks. When the deballasting operation is completed, the ballast handling records, as prescribed in the Water Ballast Management Plan, must be filled in. What are the two main reasons for maintaining an even keel and zero list of the vessel when topping off tanks? If the vessel is loading more than one grade of crude oil, there will be reduced rate, topping off tanks and change of grade, all which require increased attention and will normally be supervised by the chief officer. On large crude oil tankers, it is important to keep the vessel as close to even keel and zero list as possible in order to reach the correct quantity in the tanks. An even keel and zero list is also an important factor in case of an oil leakage from cargo lines or overtopping of tanks. Any oil on deck can be localized near its origin without flowing down the sloping deck. Why is all sampling and ullaging of cargo tanks done through totally enclosed gauging points? When the loading is completed, the cargo surveyors, assisted by the junior officers, pumpman, bosun with deck crew, or those assigned to take part, start the cargo survey. It is now mandatory that all sampling, dipping for water, temperature reading, and ullaging must be through enclosed sampling hatches. The gauging points are totally enclosed to allow gauging to be done without toxic and flammable gases and VOX from the cargo tank coming into contact with air and the people doing the gauging. At the same time as the cargo survey takes place, the cargo hoses arms are disconnected and the manifolds blanked under the supervision of the duty deck officer. When shore figures are taken to be the official final quantity of cargo loaded on board, why does the terminal require the ship's quantity calculated by the chief officer and the surveyor before releasing the cargo papers? When the cargo survey is completed, the chief officer and the cargo surveyors independently calculate the cargo, and when they are in agreement of cargo figures, the figures are given to the terminal. If the ship and shore figures are equal or within acceptable difference limits, the cargo is released and the vessel can leave the port. The loaded quantity determined by the terminal is usually taken to be the final official quantity. However, if the cargo papers, such as the bill of lading, are released before the ship has checked its own quantities and found not to be close to the terminal's figures, then the master may refuse to sign the cargo papers.